Good morning, dear students. So today I'm going to teach you something that is very important for you, especially because you are going to your semester 5. Idathrakku important onnum alla, but still I'm going to take this class because I found that some university questions had been based on this particular topic. Okay, so you have an essay to study which is not taken by many, but still we are going to learn it. And the name of the essay is "What is a Classic" by T.S. Eliot, and here I have compiled a summary. We can go through that. Okay, now I've told you earlier what a classic is, something that stands the test of time, and that is what T.S. Eliot is also saying. T.S. Eliot can be said as a great poet, as well as he is a person who can be associated as a great modern critic. Okay, you know what is criticism? Criticism means nirupana. Okay, so here you can say that the essay was presented in 1944 at the Virgil Society and later published in 1945, and then it was collected in another one book in the year 1956. And here Eliot begins his points. He tells about his viewpoints based on classic. Okay, by classic Eliot means a work that reflects the maturity of a culture, so something that gives the maturity to a culture, that is known as a classic. Indeed, he argues that classics can occur only when a civilization is mature. That means every time a classic is taking place, the civilization will be mature at that time. The Elizabethan age can be said as the nest of singing birds. So in this particular age, great classics were born. In the same way, you can see that several other civilizations like the Greek civilizations, the Roman civilization, etc., were so mature that the culture that was exhibited in that particular time paved way to different classics. Okay, so in a way you can see that this classics are born out of different culture. And you can see that the culture differs. Each age will have each culture. So a culture of a particular era may not be the culture of another era, but the classic will of course stand the test of time. Okay, Eliot had at this time been preparing the preliminary essays. These are all general things about Eliot. And here we are coming to the important part. Okay, he makes his association further along with the obligatory reference to William Shakespeare. Eliot should use as his model, he takes his model as the first Roman poet Virgil. Okay, and his famous book, the Aeneid, is called as the founding epic of Rome. It is one of the greatest masterpieces of classical age. So he takes this person, Aeneid, I mean the Virgil who wrote Aeneid, as a masterpiece, and he wants to measure Shakespeare with this particular person. Okay, so you cannot say that Virgil's Aeneid is an epic at that time, but later on it became a classic. Okay, so using this Aeneid as a running example, he requires a classical foremost which cannot be manufactured. It is only hindsight, so he keeps it as a piece of information by which he can measure the classical writers of the later period. Okay, by the same token, there has to be a history behind it. That means, in order to understand the real classic, you should have to understand what is a classic and which are the great classics. Suppose you write a poem, you write a fictional work, if you want it to be a classic, you must know what is the meaning of classic, what defines a classic, and how the previous classics are the same as the elements in your classic. Okay, so here he keeps the Virgil's Aeneid as a classic and Virgil as his model to observe the literary style of the later society. Okay, and when you are asked a question based on this, you should have to write this one, that is, out of that kind of a culture, okay, can come that final ingredient, maturity of mind. Out of a mature culture can only come a maturity of mind, and that sort of maturity Eliot feels that requires both history and the consciousness of history. That means, in order to understand a classic, you should have to understand your history, the precursors before you, who all were there, and who are the people who developed the history. Okay, so you should have to have a purview, or you should have to have a view about that. In other words, Virgil must find all these conditions available to him. So these conditions are available to him. A mature culture is there, a mature kind of a society is there, by which he can be mature in his thinking. And only with this mature thinking can he develop the right kind of a classical spirit. Okay, thereby the characters and situations that Virgil makes, or Virgil does in his writings, is in a manner that which he sees in his society, that which is called or can be called as a civilized or a more matured and thoughtful society. Okay, so he says that the great poets such as Shakespeare or Milton may exhaust a form as it has come to be developed in that culture. So these people, Shakespeare and Milton, are not from the age of Virgil, but they exhibit the kind of culture that can be found in their own respective times. When by contrast the poet in question is like Virgil, the classical poet, okay, he exhausts not a formally but the language of his time, and the language of his time as used by him will be the language in its perfection. So you can see that the classical period is the best period. It's always termed as the best period of writing. So during this classical period, there was a whole lot of writings that was exhibited. And these classical writings always incorporated or helped the people in thinking more widely. Okay. And this period cannot be contrasted with any other period of the next or the succeeding classical writers. Okay. Now, if however the setting work is truly to achieve the status of a classic, it must not have seized the right historical moment and exhausted the possibilities of the languages, but transcended even purely literary values. So you can see that the successors cannot live in the period of Virgil. In order to create a classic, they were born in a later period, and therefore they cannot be born at the period of Virgil. So what happens here is that in order to understand the classic or the elements that make a piece of literary work a classic, the later writers should have the great perspective of what is the history of classic and who are the great classical writers, and therefore they should have the consciousness of the history of the classic. Okay, so then only the person or any writer can become a classical writer. So what such a poet leaves behind is a legacy. Any classical writer leaves behind a legacy. His name is always embedded in the classical work that is known later by his name, and therefore this legacy will be followed by the next succeeding writers. Okay, and therefore he brings about the right definition of the classic, which is a product of its time, place, and cultural, linguistic, and historical conditions, that it does not so much exhaust its form as set a new standard for what that form may achieve, should all the other conditions be propitious. So what happens here is that he is saying that a classic is a piece of writing which is a product of the particular time in which the writer was born, and the place and cultural and linguistic and historical conditions also play an indispensable part in making a classic. Okay, and these things will not exhaust its form as a new standard, but it helps it to achieve all the conditions that make it a classic, even though the situations or the environment around is propitious, okay, or against them. Then, in Virgil's case, Iliad does not stop there. Virgil's language happened to have been Latin, which is due to the Roman influence. Okay, Virgil writes in a language which with no modern language can ever hope to aspire. Okay, this Latin is always the great classical language. And Iliad asserts can achieve a classic on the order of the Virgil. So the language itself, the great classical language, Latin itself, had made this particular work something of a classic. Okay, so he says that a classic is something that makes or that meets the test of time, and it always stands as a great, great and whole thing. Okay, now Iliad is concluding his essay. He says that in celebrating Rome and in placing the Roman culture as supreme, okay, Virgil unconsciously paved the way for a new epoch in history. Virgil makes a new history. And what is that history? He makes way for a new classical order. He makes a way to a new classics in literature, a definition of classic in literature. And therefore, he led the whole of Europe into thinking what a classic is. Okay, so he led Europe towards a Christian culture which Virgil could never know. He says that a new vision is there, a new common order is there, a new harmony is there, and that can be told as the best Christian culture which the Virgil never knew at his time. At Virgil's time, Christianity was not born. Okay, so this is the main gist of the essay. What is a classic? It is very simple. ഇതിനകത്തുനിന്ന് രണ്ട് മാർക്കിൻ്റെ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ മാക്സിമം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഒരു പാരഗ്രാഫ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് മാത്രം കിട്ടത്തുള്ളൂ. സ്റ്റിൽ യു ഷുഡ് ഹാവ് ടു ബി മച്ച് ഫെമിലിയർ വിത്ത് എ പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ ടോപ്പിക്. ഐ ഹാവ് ഇൻക്ലൂഡഡ് ദ എസ്സേ, ദറ്റ് മീൻസ് ദ സിനോപ്സിസ് ഓർ ദ സമ്മറി, ഇൻ ടു യുവർ ഗൂഗിൾ ക്ലാസ് റൂം. പ്ലീസ് ലുക്ക് ഇൻ ടു ഇറ്റ്, റീഡ് ഇറ്റ്. ഓക്കെ, അതിൻ്റെ അകത്ത് കുറച്ച് കോഡ്സിലൊക്കെ കൊടുത്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. പറ്റുമെങ്കിൽ ആ കോഡ്സിലുള്ളത് കാണാപ്പാടം പഠിച്ചിട്ട് you have to write it, okay, in order to fetch more marks. Okay, then, thank you.